ketogenic diets have grown in popularity, and you know, so it, do you think that if the ketogenic diet you used, you hadn't have done a 10% protein if they had done a little bit more? I'm not sure if maybe that technically wouldn't even be a ketogenic diet, but would it have changed the IGF-1 mTOR axis as much, or?
You're bringing an important point, which is that a number of people who go on a ketogenic diet tend to compensate by increasing their protein intake, which might actually put them at risk from exactly what you're describing, increased IGF-1 signaling and increased actually risk of cancer. There's a really close correlation between your IGF-1 level and your risk of cancer. So I think this is something that needs to be considered in the future for people who are on a long-term ketogenic diet.
And with the caloric restriction diets, I think I read there was a study I remember reading that humans that end up doing caloric restriction, like there's the whole society of caloric restriction,
Yes.
they end up eating they eat, you know, 30% less calories than they normally would or whatever, something like that. But they end up eating a higher percentage of protein because it's more satiating. So humans sort of naturally gravitate to eating more protein when they're eating less food.
Yes.
And so what's interesting is a lot of those, I think you even published a study recently looking at biomarkers of aging in lymphocytes or
Yes.
monocytes.
Yes, and we saw no difference between people on calorie restriction. This points again to, and this is something important to discuss, to consider when a lot of the work that we do in the lab are done on mice that are isogenic or congenic. So these are mice that are all similar to one another. When state takes discoveries and brings, when you bring discoveries to the human population, it is critical to take into consideration the incredible variation between different people and how they might respond to the same interventions. We know from everything that we've studied in medicine that I am not the same as you are, and you are different from your neighbor in many biological responses. And that includes response to calorie restriction. I suspect that in a number of people, it will actually do them harm, and in a number of people, it will do them good. We know this when we strain, when we test different strains of mice by calorie restriction. Half of the strains actually responded by a shortening of lifespan, the other half by an increasing lifespan. So we take calorie restriction, for example, as a universal modification that will increase lifespan. It's not what is seen in the literature. And I would say the same is going to be even more true for humans. So I think this brings for me, brings up the, one of the key things that is lacking in the field of aging is the identification of biomarkers that will allow us to test on an individual basis whether the intervention or the modifications that you're imposing is actually pointing you in the right direction or in the wrong direction. And I would caution anyone who's considering doing something long-term in terms of their health to be very careful in how they feel and how, because we don't have these biomarkers of aging, they're emerging, but they're not validated. It's certainly not in the human populations. They're emerging in mice models and other models. But that's really where we will be going in the next few years, is really having true biomarkers that allow us to predict whether a given intervention is beneficial or actually hurtful.